It's the time of Thanksgiving, so you know very well that it's time to be thankful for who you are, so I'll show my eyes. Yes, kidding. I couldn't find my glasses, okay? I'm on travel, so... And for some reason I didn't find them. So maybe if I do find them, I will have another review with those glasses up. But instead, but if I not, then maybe we can say Happy Thanksgiving. And this Thanksgiving week, I will have no glasses on. But no, seriously, I just couldn't find the glasses I had taken with me. I really thought I had. Which makes me a little bit worried, because, well, I liked those ones, let me just say that. But I digress. Let's just be thankful for that and show my eyes anyway. This is the Kingdom Chapter 581. It's a late review. As I said before, I'm traveling, therefore I cannot put up the reviews as much as I want to. But it's a pretty action-packed of the one, as the despair reviewer shows that the rookies see the veterans all trying to... all actually working together in perfect union despite the fact that it's pure chaos. And also this newbie guy, you know, the one who has gotten a lot of attention recently, has actually begun to awaken himself too. Kanto, I think was his name, where even though he still is of course miles of behind the others when it comes to strength, he actually stands up and manage to stay alive and fight more well than before. Even their bodies move on instinct as they grab shields and manage to do the Go-Riki, the powerful defending move that Kyoka has summoned, where they become like rock. However, it's been noted that that method tends to dislocate shoulders, but they did it on instinct and did it very fast as well. So, well, it's not bad to say that Kanto is actually slowly beginning to awaken himself, becoming more aware of the surroundings, as we also get to meet Shuosa. It's been a while since we have seen that guy, but it's one of the more veterans of the members, of course. As Kanto and the others keep on fighting, he still mentions, as I said before, how, despite having so little food, they're being motivated more than ever to fight, thanks to the captain's speech, but also, like, he can now see a different view on the battlefield. Before, he could barely even breathe, but now he's actually getting to it. And Shosa mentions that he was the same as well. But he also mentions that it only happened when he fought beside Shin. And while Shosa says that, calls Shin an idiot, well, for a lot of his crew members, he is an idiot, and it's not so very wrong to consider that. But it's a different kind of idiot. It's a kind of head first charged in idiot, but still the kind of idiot that you always follow because of charisma, leadership, strength, as well as will. So it's no, he's an idiot when it comes to smart things, but not an idiot in personality. So she also mentions that when they formed the Haishin unit, they all realized they served an incredible captain, and every single veteran from Denryu, Sugen, Hairo, Denai, and many others have all wanted to see the same view as Shin, the view where he sees the aim of the general. And even though that they'd feel like they cannot catch up to him, he also feels like when a guy who they want to catch up to is actually asking them to lend their strength to him, then why shouldn't they fight? Kota is happy that he joined the troop, as they are currently unstoppable. Kairu 10, who finally have managed to calm down after having panicked for the couple of 20, 30, or 50 chapters, finally actually begins to analyze the moments that this is very good. However, she also is reality-basing that morale can only stretch them so far, meaning that if they will recoil, they will suffer huge. And the veteran generals from Sao also mentions this, as once again they consider this flaming blaze to be very similar to how the Queen's six generals awaken their own armies. Once again showing that the Gyukyu unit and the Heishin unit are having boundless potential. And having learned from their mistakes of underestimating the six great generals of Qin, they are actually planning on doing a different strategy. They saying that if they want to, they cannot meet them head on, because that way they can be swallowed up by the current momentum. So they actually suggest that They need to slay them, that they know, because if they do, then their morale will sink completely. However, and also, Sao's left wing will disengage and withdraw for now. So, they will basically... I mean, if they crush those leaders, the right wing will collapse. However, what I said it wrong before, that they decide to actually run away or backing off. Which is actually, while it may look cowardly, is also a smart move. Because, as I said before, I think they underestimated the six great generals before they really became great generals. And allowed to be swallowed up by their momentum. They will not do the same mistake here. So if they withdraw to back off from the right wing as much as possible, they not only worn out the right wing, but also can get reinforcements back from the other wings, including Ryboku. However, Karyu 10 mentions that the Sao backing off is not a bad choice for Queen either, because she mentions that if General Mosen moved his men forward to match them, he will be able to attack Ryboku's center army on two fronts. So if they are able to push their battle lines forward, then while the enemy is yielding ground, they maybe have a similar effect. Basically, she summarized it that this may be very well the day when the general army, Austin's army, can take the very first step forward after 12 whole days and finally move towards the decisive endgame. So when she said that, I couldn't help by thinking, is that what Austin has been planning all along? As I said before, we cannot read that general's mind. But is it very possible that all of this was part of his plan? You know, he was waiting for the right wing to make their own decisions until they could push the Sao, who instinctively would back off, and then back them off. Or is it possible that Austin is just not going to do anything like that at all? I mean, right now they seem to have created a momentum, according to Karyu 10, where Austin actually can do something. However, I wonder, will Austin really do it? Will he really move his army forward? Because will Ryboku predict this? Because if he hasn't predicted this, then I think Austin would be an idiot not to make this opportunity slide. I mean, as I said before, we still don't know why he treats his son the way he does. If it really is because Hon is not his son, and he will not move his army just because of that, then I would say that is pity beyond belief. No matter how smart you are, to let emotion jeopardize everything. So yeah, I think all the rest will depend if Sao's right wing can catch up to the Sao unit before their stamina runs out. More than that, will Austin plunge them into that? Because if they do, then we may very well see this decisive battle the way we want to. What did you think about this chapter? I mean, it was a pretty nice one. Some nice action of it all. Seeing the rookies actually begin to get more aware of it all. And the encouraging speech from Shuosai in a way. That yes, they all follow Shin. Because his charisma, leadership, strength, will, and many things more have guided them. Even his idiocy has guided them. That made it a pretty nice chapter. So give me your thoughts if you have any.